Zone you are in. Today with us, we have a very interesting person on a equally interesting and important subject to us. And that's Dr. Hamid from the United Nations University. We'll get to know him as we go by. The main reason why we've hauled him up at this unearthly hour, early morning in Eastern time, is because of this tool that the UN University has recently released. Actually, they are releasing it today, and such a privilege to have Dr. Hamid here, who's also from the subcontinent like us, from Islamabad, and he's with the UN, and he worked on this tool with the UN University, and he's worked on this tool, and the tool is called it's a flood mapping tool. So as we go by, we'll encounter it more and more. I need not tell you how important such tools are becoming in this era of climate change. We ourselves are in a place like Goa, which has had three very extreme monsoons in the past 3 years, 2019, 2020, 2021. And many other parts. We've seen television pictures of China, we've seen pictures of Europe and all that. But I won't come in between Dr. Hamid and you. And please, Doctor, it's all yours. Can you explain to us what this tool is all about, why it's relevant?
Okay. Thank you, Frederick. Thank you for this opportunity to come and present the tool. I think this is a very good platform to share it with the rest of the people who are interested in floods and impact of floods. So just going back to the rationale or what was the reason why we started this tool. So if you look at the floods, they account for approximately 54% of all the water-related disasters. And since the beginning of, let's say, 2020, in South Asia alone, floods have impacted around 18 million people, and it has caused around 1,000 deaths. And then the economic losses, they run in billions. So that's a huge number. And then we see that this is a recurring event. Every year, the intensity and the frequency of floods are going up. And then you look at how we manage that flood. So what happens is that whenever there's a flood, there's a rush of activity, and we try to manage that flood, that particular event, and then we forget about it. And then we wait for the next one. And for example, if there's an institute or there's a research institute or agency which wants to work on the previous floods and learn from the lessons, they don't have access to any kind of tool or repository which can list or map out all the historical floods for them, because those historical floods would define the future trends and scenarios, but they don't have access to the data. And this is where we thought that, okay, we should develop a tool which could map the historical floods for at least 3 decades in the past, starting from 1980s. And all that data could be used by all those research agencies to learn those important lessons and make sure that we have those the vulnerability and the risk mapping done properly, so that we are more, I would say, prepared for the future floods. Luckily, what has happened in the last 10 years is that there's been exponential increase in the computational resources that are available to us and the data that we're generating and data that we're consuming. So gone are those days when you had this one machine sitting in a lab, and then you used to download 1 GB of data, you used to spend the whole night to download that data, and then you used to process it and then share it with the community after 1 week. So all that workflow is long gone. So what happens now is that you have cloud computation platforms like Google Earth Engine, then this is Microsoft Azure Earth platform, and also from Amazon. So all of these big tech giants, which have these cloud computing platforms, they have provided these platforms to researchers and developers to work with the data and come up with solutions which have a social impact. And then this is where we reached out to Google, and we got their education research grant. And then we started working on the development of this tool. So the idea is pretty simple. What we do is that we take the Landsat satellite archive data. We create a data cube, or we stack the satellite imagery on top of each other. And then we look from top to down at each pixel. And in that each pixel, we pick up the frequency of the presence or absence of flood. So if the pixel is, let's say, 80% of the time it is water, then we say it's a permanent water body. But if it's not, then we say it's a temporary water body. So it's a pretty simple concept. People have used it in the past, but what they've done is that they've used it for a limited regions or limited time. And then again, it has never been released as a tool that can be used globally. So once we kind of optimize the methodology, the next step was validating the results. So we have validated the results primarily in Global South. We tested it out in 8 countries, and then we have published the results in a peer-reviewed publication, which can be found, which can be accessed on our website on the project page. So yeah, so that's the story. That's what motivated us where we are right now. This tool is the first step of many tools that we're trying to develop on top of it. So right now what this tool does is that it just maps out a historical flood for you, but we do understand that that information is not good enough. What we are building after that is that we want to use the historical flood maps to map the risk in a particular area. And the other thing that we want to do that while we're mapping the risk is that we realize that in Global South, especially in South Asia and Southeast Asia, when we look at the risk map, they would define risk at a town level or at a province level or at even at a district level. So the whole district would be colored red. That would mean that the whole district is under high risk. That does not make sense. It does not give any valuable information to a decision maker who take any action. What we want to do is that we want to take the risk mapping down to a street level or a parcel level. So everybody should know that, okay, that's this particular street or this particular piece of land is at high risk of flood. So we should not either construct here or we should not plan any activity which increases that risk. So that is our next step. We want to improve how we understand risk, how we disseminate the risk-related information.
So, Doctor, what's the role of the United Nations University in this project?
Okay, so what we did was that we were leading the development efforts. So all the technology was built in here, all the liaison with the tech industry was done through the UNU INWIT. What we relied on our partners is to provide us data that we can use as part of the validation exercise. So all the partners that you see listed in the news release as well as on the project page, they provided us that valuable data that we can actually use to validate the tool, which is very surprising that when we got down to the validation, we realized that there is no reliable data available to actually check out that what happened in the past to a particular flood. All you see is all these PDF files with the flood maps in them. And anybody who is into flood modeling or any kind of remote sensing GI system would know that you cannot use data that is embedded in a PDF. You would want either raster data files or vector data files to use in your model. So yeah, that is where we had to reach out to our network, to our partners, and they were kind enough to share those data with us. And then we did share the validation results with them just to verify that whatever we've done it right. Because again, it's a big ask to release a tool, and if the tool doesn't work or it's broken, then it loses its usability, and then you lose the whole point.
So you this is an open source tool.
This is an open source tool. The tool repository is available on Git. The link will be published on the project page. You can just go and fork the tool. To deploy it at your end, probably you'll have to deploy it on a VM or any of the cloud services. But then again, we will be providing detailed instructions on how to actually deploy a tool. At the back end, the algorithm that's working to map the flood, it's been published as a peer-reviewed application, all the steps and the validation, as well as how do you actually differentiate between temporary water and permanent water or inundation maps. All of that has been published, so you can go and access that.
Would you like to demo something of the tool?
Oh, yeah, sure. So I hope everybody can see the screen. I'll just remove. Okay. So this is the tool interface right now. On the right side hand, we have the options menu. And then in the center, you have step is always to select the country. So all of the countries are listed here. Whenever you select a country, click OK. and it will zoom into the country and it will show you a grid. So this grid maps to the dimensions of a Landsat imagery. So you can zoom into the area that you like, and then you can select the grid that you are interested in. So when I select a grid, it changes the grid color to white. After that, what you can do is that you can start the enter the flood start date and the flood end date. I'll just pick up a flood that we had in Canada back in 2019. So I'm going to pick up the start date as, 1st of April. And I say that the flood ended somewhere in June. So, okay. And once I've selected the date, I just click on update map. So what will happen is the algorithm will pick up the dates and the area and the area of interest, and it will map up the flood for us. And then you can see that the legend shows that the red, the area in the red is the inundated area, and the blue one are the permanent water bodies. Just to verify the results, you can see that the blue ones are the river that's running, and the red ones are the area that has been inundated. The other thing that we've added in here is that, especially that would work very nicely in South Asia and Southeast Asia, is that you can have a 3D view of the flood, how it's behaving. So you can just go in and do click on the 3D view. Because we don't have a lot of variation in the topography over here, so you'll not be seeing a lot of variance. But then again, this functionality is available, and it looks kind of nice and adds to the your visual analysis when you're doing that. The other thing that we've done is that we've added the building data. If you go to a mega city like Mumbai or Calcutta, you will see a lot of if there's a flood, you can see the analysis with the urban centers or the buildings, and you can actually map out the buildings which are impacted most by the floods. And then the last thing that you can do is that we have added two additional data sets, the population density and the land use land cover. We plan to add more data sets over here which can enable the socioeconomic analysis or socioeconomic vulnerability and risk mapping. Right now, we just have the population that's coming from the WorldPop data, and the land use land cover is coming from the Global Land Cover Mapping project. And in the end, once you're done and you want to integrate it with some other data sets that you have here, or you want to generate a PDF map, what you can do is that you can download the map or the data sets. You can write in the email, and then you can download it, and it will be emailed to you. The download link will be emailed to your Gmail address. So again, we have tried to keep the workflow very simple. You select the country, you enter the dates, and you update the map, and it will do everything else for you. We have generated or created an extensive help document, so you can just go and look at all the documents. And this is the 3D building data that I was talking about. You can actually go and zoom in, and you can look at the building data and the 3D data. So yeah, that's pretty much it. We will be improving. We do understand that as the tool is used, there will be improvements, there will be feedback, and that is where we rely on you, that you just help us improve this tool. You use it for your flood mapping. If you see anything that is lacking in terms of accuracy or data sets, then you just let us know. In near future, we will be adding another data set to the backend. Right now, it's only using Landsat. We will add the Sentinel data as well, so that will improve both the temporal and spatial resolution. So it's not that we've just released this version. There will be future version as well, and we need your help to improve those versions. So I'm really relying on the community to give us that feedback.
That's very interesting, Doctor, and it's really insightful. Two last questions before we let you go. Of course, for those who came in late, I'm speaking to Dr. Hamid Mahmood, who is a GIS and remote sensing specialist at the UNU, INWEH. Of course, we know that the UN loves its abbreviation. So the first and the easy question is, what does INWEH stand for?
Okay, that's an excellent question. So INWE stands for the Institute for Water, Environment, and Health. It is one of the institutes of United Nations universities. Our headquarters is based in Japan. We are around 8 institute located all over the world. The INWE is located in Canada, but then again, if you if you're in South Asia, you will have the closest institute in Macau. That's the UNG Macau that deals with the computer science and the digital technologies. So we are the academic arm of UN. If there's any kind of research that needs to happen for a particular cause or a particular issue, we do that research. INWE deals in water, environment, and health, and we are labeled as the UN's global think tank on water. A lot goes through us. There's a lot of input from our side in the policymaking side or anything related to SDG 6 indicators.
And in these times of global change, last question, in these times of global change, what is the role that you see for say, GIS and remote sensing to, you know, help us to find problems for these solutions for these huge problems in that sense?
That's a very interesting question, and that's a very that's a question that's discussed a lot in the GIS and remote sensing community. What has happened in last 5 or 10 years is that GIS and remote sensing has turned into a cross-cutting technology. So if you pick up any research institute or a global think tank, all of its departments or agencies would be using GIS and remote sensing in some form or the other. And it provides that critical evidence and critical data that is that gives provides the seed for the rest of the model or rest of the studies to be built on. I think GIS remote sensing has evolved a lot. It has kept pace with the advancement in the technology. It has made sure that it integrates the data from UAVs, from the sensors, from the IoTs. It starts using the cloud computing platform, and it's evolving at a rapid pace. And I see a very bright future for remote sensing GIS, and I think it will make a lot of contributions in addressing the global challenges and helping us meet the sustainable development goals.
Doctor, thank you so much for your time and for taking this special effort to meet us and talk to our audiences. Thanks so
thank
much.
You. Thank you so much,
pleasure
Frederick.
Pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. Same here.
Bye. All the best. Have a nice day.
Thank you. You too. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.